the ball when the game was on the line in the Lakers' recent loss to the Hawks. Then he unfavorably compared him to his former teammate Michael Jordan and Kobe Bryant. Pippen said this, "When I look at LeBron, he's not what Michael was as a player. He's not even what Kobe Bryant was as a player. So when you talk about trying to compare Michael's instinct, his ability to take over games, his ability to want to have the last shot, LeBron doesn't have that gene. That's not in him. Kobe has that gene. It's that clutch gene. I'm not taking it away that he doesn't know how to win and he's not willing to have the ball in his hands. But the players that have that clutch gene, they're going to go get that ball." So, Skip.
Interesting.
What was your reaction to that quote?
Tread carefully.
I was pleasantly surprised. I completely agreed with everything Scottie Pippen said for once, because I haven't always or even often agreed with things that he said. And in the end, I was honored and flattered by what he said, because the irony was that on my old show, First Take, Scottie Pippen used the phrase I'm pretty sure I coined back in about 2005, which was LeBron's second year in the league, and my second year is actually 04-05, going into my second year on a show called Cold Pizza that became First Take. But I'm pretty sure I came up out of nowhere with that phrase clutch gene, because as I watched young LeBron, wildly talented, wildly gifted, and I started calling the best driver of the basketball I'd ever seen, the best attacker of the basket I'd ever seen, it looked to me like at the end of games, he did often run from the basketball, or at least and especially from the free throw line. LeBron James, early on in his career, wanted no part of driving, getting fouled, and having to go stand by himself at the free throw line and make two to tie, heaven forbid, or even one of two to win a game. He wanted no part of that. So, highest IQ I've ever seen on a basketball floor, what did he start doing? He started making the right play by passing to teammates who had far less clutch gene than even LeBron had, or he started shooting jump shots, three-point shots from Akron. He was shooting 30-footers, high degree of difficulty shots to win games, because that way the media would give him a pass, because everybody would say, boy, he took a really hard shot, and we can't really expect LeBron to make that shot. But I kept saying, well, wait a second. Why doesn't he just call for the ball and drive it to the basket and either make the shot or and one the shot and get to the free throw line and close the deal? I kept saying, as all-time talented as LeBron James is, that's not his strength. He was not born with the clutch gene. And over his first 15 years in the league, because I watch every LeBron game, I can document the jump shots that he made to win basketball games. And they were at Golden State, January 23rd. It was a Friday night. Ernestine and I were at our place in New York City watching this game. 2009, he made a jumper over Ronnie Turioff of the Golden State Warriors.
3 days before the All-Star game.
Yeah, and it was a big-time shot. Way to go, LeBron. So that was number one. And then he hit that shot heard around the world, which was basically, I got to shoot this. Remember this one? Where he just caught the inbounds pass from Mo Williams on Turkoglu, and he just turned and shot it. And
you see? See what you did?
Yeah.
You see how you minimized it?
Wait a second. I'll give you that one, except I will have to minimize what happened after that in that series.
They lost.
They just fell on their face after that against the Orlando Magic. And then it was the mad shot at Chicago, where the soon-to-be ex-coach David Blatt called a play to win the game for Kyrie Irving. And LeBron said something, no. And he said, I want the ball in bounds. And he got mad and he shot. It wasn't a three-point shot. It was a two-point shot. It was inside the line from the corner. And he flat out shot it mad and made it to win the game at Chicago. And then last year, that was his 15th year in the league. So through 14 years, he had three buzzer beaters from outside the paint. So then last year, he hit the one over Jimmy Butler.
If they're buzzer beaters, why does it matter if they're outside the paint, if they're buzzer beaters?
Okay, well, I'm going to give you this one. The one over Jimmy Butler, the one against the Pacers, even though they were completely discombobulated.
No, don't do that, Skip.
LeBron had goaltended, and they're all standing around saying, you're not going to call that?
Skip, don't do that.
And he goes to the other end and makes the shot to win the game, and they're still standing around saying, well, we got robbed.
Do you see what you did?
I'm not doing anything. I'm just telling you the truth of what happened. And then the Raptors, remember, they inbounds the ball at the end, and it's against a rookie.
Again, it's a caveat. And you said you wanted
what were the caveat on all three of those shots last year? Safety net.
Ball game.
Safety net.
Ball game.
You know, high IQ, you know if I miss this shot, it's not do or die. The game is tied. I've got overtime. I've got a safety net.
We can't say he won the game. There's always a caveat. Right. See, here's the thing.
But that was year 15 last year. Boy, it took a long time to get there.
You know, early on, Jenny, you know what I wanted to be when I was growing up?
What?
I wanted to be a geneticist.
Really?
You know, Skip, I wanted to study genes.
I did not know that.
I did, yeah, because, you know, my grandpa.
What, you mean like Levi's?
No.
I don't know.
Actually, Sergio, what was the big gene? Calvin Klein?
Yeah. Sure.
Sergio Rigoletto was a big gene back in my day.
See,
Lee?
You did
Lee
study genes.
Yeah. Dungarees, you know, Wrangler.
Wrangler,
what you wore back in the day.
I'd never wore Wranglers
in my life.
God is my witness, I've never owned one pair of Wranglers. I don't even know what they look like.
They're coming back.
I wanted to study this because I wanted to know, was there a condition? Because it seemingly, I learned later on, even though I didn't go into that field, that sometimes we're predisposed. Mm. There is a gene that you're predisposed that's inherited, maybe hypertension or thyroid function or certain types of cancers. Now, I'm going to get on this and see if there's a clutch gene. I want them to study that because, you know, I want to make sure my kid has that. You know, my kid, I need to have my kids tested. I ain't got no, have no kid. But anyway, that's not what I'm saying. You see what happened? I want Scottie Pippen to make up his mind. Because just a couple of years ago, he said LeBron James has surpassed Michael Jordan, given what he's asked to do and the level of talent that's around him. That's what he's saying. Now he goes to Charlotte. Jenny, if you don't mind me asking, who owns the team in Charlotte?
Oh, I think it's that guy we've been talking about.
Whose birthday was it this past weekend? So he's in
Charlotte. Yesterday. Yeah, go ahead.
Like you knew he was listening.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we know Michael hears everything.
Okay.
And when he said that before that LeBron James, I'm sure he got a call from someone. So now he goes out of his way. For a guy that's not clutch, how does he have more game-winning playoff baskets than Michael Jordan? For a guy that's not clutch. And when he's clutch, you try, well, outside the paint. Now outside the paint. Now we can't say game-winning. Because, see, if he hits a game-winning free throw, well, that's just a free throw. We got to always find a different way how to undermine what LeBron has done. You see, the very thing that you want LeBron to do is hoist up bad shots in the end of possessions like Kobe, you criticized Russell Westbrook for. Now Russell Westbrook is taking a back seat. And here, another thing, Scotty, I don't know how much basketball you watching. Because before this year, the only game-winning and last-second shots Paul George was making was in a Gatorade commercial. But this year, he's been money. I will concede that. But you criticize Russ for taking bad shots late in the shot clock, late in ball games.
Okay.
Now you want LeBron to do that. But because he won't acquiesce, he says, you know what, why would I jack up a bad shot when I got a teammate that's in the NBA that got a better shot. So I'll pass up a bad shot or a good shot to get a great shot. You see, the
so you want George Hill taking the shot of shots that's going to win game one of last year's finals.
And here's
really?
You know what I like? You know,
George Hill?
Michael Jordan is the all-time great pitch man. Be like Mike. I wish I could fly. But he had a commercial that he did with Nike. And this is what he said. And I wrote this down. I was up late last night, Skip. Burning the midnight oil. Because you know what, Skip? I had gotten used to getting up at like 8 o'clock in the morning. You don't sleep until 8 o'clock. I'm like, man, let me sit this long.
But a little different.
This was Michael Jordan's Nike commercial. And this is the time he was still playing. I've missed more than 9,000 shots in my career. I've lost almost 300 games. 26 times I've been trusted to take the game-winning shot and missed. I've failed over and over again in my life. And that's why I succeed.
Do you want me to start on all the ones that he made? Yeah.
So this notion that Skip Bayless and Scottie Pippen and Michael Jordan apologists would have you believe that Michael Jordan never missed a last second shot. He never missed a game-winning shot. I watched Michael Jordan's career. I remember when he was a freshman, and I followed him all the way.
Well, what did he do in the national championship game when he was 18 years old?
He hit the game-winning shot.
Thank you. Was it outside the paint?
Hold on, if you don't mind me asking, where was he at 18?
Yes.
In college. Mm-hmm. My guy, 18, was a grown man paying light bill, phone bill, gas bill, and supporting a mama. Mm-hmm. Where was Michael Jordan again?
What will any player who's played over the last 30, 40 years in the NBA tell you is the biggest, best money player in the history of the game? Michael Jeffrey Jordan.
But Skip,
they'll all tell you that.
Skip. Let's just say, for the sake of argument, I were to concede that to you, which I never will, because I don't believe it's true.
You know it's true. You want to get invited
to that party. But that's not what Scottie said. Scottie said the man didn't possess the clutch gene, which is a lie.
And he's comparing it to Michael Jordan and Kobe. And he said at the end of games, they want the basketball. LeBron doesn't always want the basketball. But they want to make it happen.
Would you rather Tom Brady force the ball into triple coverage to Gronk, or throw it to a wide-open Chris Hogan?
You know what? I think on the pass that won the Super Bowl, he forced it into almost triple coverage to Gronk.
No, he had one-on-one.
29.
But Skip.
But he dropped it right down the chimney between three.
Skip, but I'm just trying to figure. He got more game-winning playoff shots than Kobe and Michael, yet he's not clutch. And when I say, so we're not going to talk about that last-second shot that he hit against Indiana when he beat Paul George, the best two-way player in basketball. That you remember that one, Skip?
You mean just the left-handed layup?
It's a left-handed layup.
It's off the glass.
Is that a game-winning shot?
Just laid it in. Yes, but I told you, outside the paint.
Ask Patrick Ewing.
Who couldn't make
that? Ask Patrick Ewing how hard game-winning layups are.
George Hill could have made that layup.
Yeah, he couldn't.
Yeah. George Hill.
Skip, all I'm saying is, if that you don't give a caveat when you talk about game winners. Mm. Because you never say that about Michael. You don't say game winning shots that Michael hit outside the paint. Mm. You don't say that with Kobe. We never say that by any other all-time great player hitting a game winning shot except LeBron.
Do you remember the Craig Elo shot? Do you remember the Brian Russell shot at Utah?
Yeah, I remember.
I was there.
Yeah.
I saw it.
And guess what, Skip? In 20 years, they're going to play that Hedo Turkoglu shot. Mm-hmm. They're going to play that shot against Indy. Because remember now, they weren't playing that shot, that Craig Elo shot, when Michael Jordan was playing like they do now. Mm-hmm. When we look back, we're going to look back and see LeBron going the length of the court against Toronto. Mm-hmm. He was a rookie.
The problem with LeBron is you forget how many shots he passed up that he should have taken, such as at the end of regulation last year, game one at Oakland. You got him on the ropes, but you're down one, and you got the basketball, and you get the switch you want with little Steph on you.
You play poker?
Pull up and shoot it.
Do you play poker?
Pull up and shoot it.
You do play poker?
I used to.
Okay, so you know you got to throw away a lot of bad hands before you play the hand that you think you can win. So LeBron James is going to pass a lot of bad shots to get that one sweet one.
Okay, like we're going to leave it for now. No more poker talk. Why does Antonio Brown keep going after Big Ben? He's been busy. We'll discuss what he's been saying next.